I'm speaking about the topic of This Changes Everything, about various real shifts in practice in medical oncology that are just occurring now that are really quite fundamental. One of these, and I'm going to list five, one of these is the shift to a much more granular look at oncology that is now becoming much more molecular oncology. We are already well into this process where lung cancer, for instance, which used to be just seen as small cell or non-small cell, is now broken down into a pie chart that is increasingly complex with narrower slivers. And so it's really changing how we practice when we need to individualize our treatments incredibly more than we used to before, where you basically give the same regimen to everybody. At the same time, we are increasingly using next generation sequencing. That is going to, I think, become the norm right around now and in the next few years, and should make things even more complex. As a consequence, the second issue is that we need to change how we disseminate and gather our information, because you can't carry it in your head anymore. It is so expansive that it is ridiculous to think that you can keep up with everything. In the field that I focus on, which is lung cancer, we've had the enviable problem of new positive trials every few weeks with a new press release changing practice potentially. And because of that, you really just can't carry it in your head. You need to get information really in a just-in-time way. So that means that just like we've moved away from textbooks because they're just too outdated by the time they're in hardback on your bookcase, even print journals are becoming obsolete or at least challenged when the newest information is coming in iterations that are just a few weeks to months old. Things are advancing so quickly, we need to find information in a just-in-time way, often looking online in a search for things. The third trend is the changing role of patients, especially the more sophisticated so-called e-patients, and the rise of patient groups, which comes as part of the same process of having increasingly complex and narrow populations. This leads to the self-aggregation of these patients online with a 1 or 2% kind of mutation. There's not enough for them to all be in one city at the same time, but they find each other now online, which eliminates the geographic issues. And they share information in a way that allows them to keep up with what's happening more than just about any doctor can. Certainly anybody seeing a few different kinds of cancer every day can't spend an hour a day focusing on a 1% mutation. But these people eat, sleep, live, and breathe this. Their life is at stake over it. And they share everything that is available to be known about the drugs that are on the market and also the most impressive trials. And so this changes the dynamic, the knowledge that the patients may know more than the docs, and that's not always a bad thing. In fact, that's going to be a consequence of the narrowing of the field into smaller and smaller populations and these people finding each other and sharing information online. And we, as oncologists, need to change our relationship to be partners with them rather than have us and them rely on only us providing information to them. A fourth issue is the increasing recognition that metastatic disease is not just a binary issue of once it's metastatic, the horse is out of the barn and we can't cure this. There is more of a spectrum of metastatic disease, and we're increasingly appreciating that patients with a single focus or a few areas of small volume disease may possibly do very, very well with more aggressive systemic therapies, potentially combined with local therapies like radiation or possibly surgery, and if not cured, do so well for so long that it really changes the game. And the other issue is that it's not just an issue of you have to treat for cure or what's the point. You can help patients with metastatic disease, even if it's not curative, if they live far longer by getting a local consolidation therapy, which is not for every patient, but is potentially a real appropriate option for a selected minority is a good choice. So I think there's going to need to be more viewing of metastatic disease in a nuanced way, and the same for progression of disease, that some minor progression should not lead to a reflexive dropping what you're on and switching to something else, that it really depends on how much and how extensive that progression is. And then the last issue is the view of metastatic disease or the disease journey in general with cancer as a very longitudinal one, that we need to focus less on just the next treatment and the goals for how long this progression-free survival is, and think about a sequential therapy that is a luxury now of having so many effective therapies available for various treatment settings, that we can intelligently begin to try to test the best ways to sequence things, whether we should combine multiple approaches up front or sequence them over time, and which order might make a difference. Now that we have immune therapies and there may be differences in how responsive patients are to chemo after immune therapy or vice versa, this is a question that we will need to address more and more in the next several years. And it's with a goal of having people live for years and years at a time and really take the long goal strategy rather than being too focused just on the next 6 or 12 months. So a lot of change is happening, and it's just an exciting time to be in oncology, but it's also a scary time because everything that we've done for years and decades in oncology is becoming less relevant in a new world of molecular and immunologic oncology.